الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لدين الإسلام وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يؤتي الملك من يشاء وينزعه ممن يشاء، يعز من يشاء ويذل من يشاء، بيده الخير، إنه على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدًا صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم عبد الله ورسوله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة وجاهد في الله حتى أتاه اليقين. May all the praise be to Allah, the one who guided us to this deen of Islam. And I witness that Allah is the only God, the one and the only one who provides life and provides death. He is the one who installs people in authority and the one who removes them away. The one who provides dignity and the one who provides humiliation. And I witness that Allah is the only God, the only one to be worshipped. And I witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is the final and last messenger of Allah. He was designated as a mercy for all mankind. Dear brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Let me just to start by saying I'm very glad and happy to be back again among the brothers whom I lived with for many years. And may Allah Azza wa Jal bless this gathering and those who were in charge and responsible for creating a place like this one. Jazakumullahu khair. And then looking around the world today, the one ayah that comes to my mind and can pull out my emotions and my thoughts and provoke everything in me is that ayah that Allah Azza wa Jal, he addressed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions at the time after they migrated to Medina and they've just finished the Battle of Badr. Battle of Badr was the first major battle in Islam where decisive victory was for Muslims under the leadership of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Islamic leadership with the Messenger of Allah, which was supposed to last forever and ever and ever. And as long as it's there, that leadership, that victory will always be there. And as once that leadership is missed, we will see what we see around us in the entire world today. That ayah where he says to the Muslims, وَذْكُرُوا إِذْ أَنْتُمْ قَلِيلٌ مُسْتَضْعَفُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Remember when you were so few, so oppressed, chased around in this earth, in the land, and that was the status of the Muslims in Mecca. فأواكم الله وأيدكم بنصره. Allah provided you a safe haven in Medina, created for you an entity where Islam was practiced. وأيدكم بنصره. And he supported you with a victory from him. And Allah in another place says, إن ينصركم الله فلا غالب لكم. If Allah provides his support and victory, no one can defeat you. وإن يخذلكم. If he let you on your own, فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ. Who's going to provide you victory? Security Council, IJC, United Nations, United States, Britain, Europe, Russia, who? Countries, zombie countries here and there in the Muslim world? No one. If Allah Azza wa Jal let go of his hand, his big hand, his power, from supporting you, you will have no victory whatsoever. وَيَخْذُلْكُمْ فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Upon Allah and only Allah, you should have your complete reliance. Complete reliance. As long as you see Muslims all over the world rush to the Security Council, United Nations, to the IJC, all of these international court of justice, ICJ, I'm sorry. You run to all of these things, okay, go and get your victory there and you'll see what happens. And we did, we all saw what happened. And what's happening. وَذْكُرُوا إِنْ أَنْتُمْ قَلِيلٌ مُسْتَضْعَفُونَ بِالْأَرْضِ. In other words, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a messenger for mankind, the status of the world at that time is very similar to what we see today. Idols. People were worshipping stones, idols. Put them around the Kaaba, Baytullah al-Haram. إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ وُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ الَّذِي بِمَكَّةَ. This is the first house built for to worship Allah Azza wa Jal was the one in Mecca. And around that place, there were so many idols. And those idols, then, they do represent the same idols that you see all over the Muslim world today. They're idols. An idol, what's an idol? An idol is a symbolic thing that does not give you any value, neither good nor bad. It's almost, it is helpless. And today, when you look at tens of thousands of people being massacred on a daily basis, and those who sit around in all of these big chairs, golden, made out of gold, these are idols, because they are absolutely useless. They cannot provide any help or support. Just like the idols in Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came in a place where the idols were the gods, were in the place of gods. Where the idols were the ones that people look up for when they can do nothing for themselves. And you all know the story that when some of the tribes of the Arabs, they decided to make an idol out of dates. They had lots of dates. That's the crops that grows the most in that area. They made an idol, a god, out of dates. And one of these years where they could not have enough food, they went and ate their god. And they say, أكلت العرب ربها. The Arabs ate their own god. Arabs ate their own gods. I hope these Arabs today, they eat their own god idols that they have put them in all of these places, because they are absolutely useless. But then Allah Azza wa Jal tells these Muslims that when you were there and you stood against all types of oppression, oppression, you can't even imagine how serious and bad that oppression was. We know what oppressive regimes are today. We know massacres, we know killings, we know discrimination. But in that community, in the world, it was even worse. It was the peak. And that was the wisdom that Allah Azza wa Jal had when he designated Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a world that has the utmost serious oppressive regimes and conditions in the world. Talk about discrimination, they had it. Talk about slavery, they had it. They had the worst type of slavery ever. The worst type of slavery ever. Someone gives you a loan and you cannot pay it on time. And later on we say, here, I have money. No, I don't need your money. I need your wife to come to serve me and to be my friend or something at house. Enslaving the wife of a man simply because he was not able to pay a few bucks. Enslaving children. Many of the slaves that happened in Mecca, in particular, were slaves of riba, slaves of usury. To the point, the discrimination against women, sometimes they say, oh, women riot, not women riot. The time Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent in Mecca, people used to take a child, if she is born a girl, إِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. When his wife pregnant, now she is giving birth, the doctors or the nurse or whoever says, oh, you had a beautiful daughter. Then he says, وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا. His face turned dark and he's so sad and doesn't know what to do. أَيُمْسِكُهَا عَلَى هُمْ. Just keep it with humiliation. Humiliation of having a girl, or يدسها في التراب, or he just buried here in under the ground. Even today we don't have, well, we do. With all of the abortions, etc., it's almost similar, almost similar. But the abortion today is not only for girls, for anyone. That was Mecca. Mecca, they used to have double standard, double scales, المطففون. قل يا أيها المطففون. There is the مطفف, the one who has two different scales. If I sell you something, I use my scale that gives you less product. If I buy from you, I use a different scale so I can get more. That was Mecca. And in the surrounding of Mecca, the Romans and Persians were even worse. What is even worse? I live in a place in my country in Jordan where there is a theater called the Roman Theater. So we go and show our visitors there. There's a Roman theater. And in the Roman theater, there's a stage. And that stage has, it's a wooden, it used to be concrete, etc. Wooden, there was a big hole. They covered that hole. But then what they do? They bring two people in order to fight or to wrestle. Wrestlers, called Roman wrestling. Today we have seen the wrestlers. We know how much they beat each other. In front of the people, just watch me hitting the face of someone or bleeding him. But the Romans, they used to wrestle until someone falls in that hole. And beneath the hole there is two lions which have been hungry for almost a week. And those people, the wrestlers, they have to be non-white Romans. And until today, there are photos or drawings of those people. I have not seen a single wrestler who fell in that hole who belonged to the white race. Today, we have oppression like that, but that is a very big symbolic. In that environment, the Prophet ﷺ was designated as a messenger. In that environment, the Prophet ﷺ faced all types of atrocities. In that environment, Allah says, قليل, small, few. مستضعفون, مستضعف is a derivative of the word weak, but a مستضعف is not a weak, is not weak. Weak means you don't have abilities. You don't have abilities, you are too weak, you cannot even move your hands, you cannot shake, you cannot walk, you can. That's a weak. But مستضعف is the one who was overpowered. His hands are cuffed, his legs are tied, so you can do nothing. That's مستضعف. And مستضعف is like us in this room. We are not weak. We have absolute enormous power. Among us, there are the engineers, there are the doctors, there are the scientists. They are the workers, they are the ones who can move mountains. Who can move mountains. But we have been handcuffed. The Muslim Ummah. Now, when I say this room, that means we are representative of the Ummah. The Muslim Ummah. All of the Ummah, when we saw, we have seen what happened in Gaza. What's happening? The entire Ummah went up roaring, shouting, trying, showing all its energy. But they are mustadafiyan. They are mustadafin because the resources of the places where they live in, it's in the hand of the enemy, in the hand of the idol. The big military, military armies around Gaza, Egypt, Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, and move a little bit, Turkey, Iran, Iraq, move, Pakistan, all of these, they have big, big armies. The total number of soldiers in the Muslim world who carry the name Muhammad and Abdullah and Abdurrahman and Saeed and Ali and Ahmed and the number of them is hundreds of millions of brothers, hundreds of millions. The number of money, the amount of money which was spent for building these armies, not billions, it's trillions of dollars all over the Muslim world, handcuffed, crippled, mustadafin, each and every one of them. And I am a first-hand witness on soldiers, officers in the country of Jordan where I live, where they're dying to be able to move, but handcuffed. Legs tied down. Crippled. Mustadafin, that's what a mustadaf. A mustadaf And Allah Azza wa Jal, when He used the word, He's the Almighty, He's the All-Knowing. This word was used several times. In Surah Al-Qasas, Allah Azza wa Jal talks about the people of Musa vis-a-vis the Fir'aun. وَنُرِيدُ أَن نَمُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا. We want to bestow our favor upon those who were مستضعفين, مستضعفين overpowered. وَنَجْعَلَهُمْ أَئِمَّةً. We will make them the imams, the leaders. وَنَجْعَلَهُمُ الْوَارِثِينَ and the inheritors. Just imagine the oppressed man, oppressed woman, oppressed people, oppressed nations. The ones who are overpowered, the ones who are crippled, the ones who have no ability to move. Then out of a sudden they become the leaders. Allah changes the situation. The situations in the world is never static. For people who understand the word static means stalemate, doesn't change. It's dynamic, changes. And quite often it does change to a point where you will never expect it. Who would expect that the oppressed people, the overpowered people in any nation, like America, can anyone imagine or expect the indigenous people, Red Indians, at some point, they will be the ones in charge of this country? Or you say, you are crazy, this cannot happen. Or the African Americans who were brought into this country out of slavery, enslaving people, free people, people who can move mountains, bring them in ships and make them slaves here and later on keep under the all types of oppression. Anyone who would say, oh, there will come a time when this country, big country ruled by the minorities or the ones who were oppressed, oh no, you are out of your mind, it doesn't happen. Can anyone imagine that the people that Fir'aun was able to kill their, or slaughter, not kill, slaughter the children, يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. See, the words that Allah uses in the Quran are absolute words. You cannot replace them by anything else. You cannot say, kill the children. يُذَبِّحُ, الذَبِح, slaughter, children. وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ. He enslaves, يَسْتَحْيِي does not mean keep them alive, enslaves the woman. Slaughter, men, children, keeps the woman, slavery. يُذَبِّحُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَيَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاءَهُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Was a person who caused corruption. And then he says, these people, Allah Azza wa Jal says, these مستضعفين, I will make them the leaders of that place. I will replace the throne of Fir'aun with a throne of someone from among these people. And didn't Yusuf alayhi salam come after a while and he became the king or the leader of that country? He did. And that leadership vanished only when the people who followed Yusuf and Musa alayhi salam, they went astray. In other words, when Allah Azza wa Jal bestow a favor upon you, upon the Muslims, upon this ummah, and you make them the leaders, that is not an open call that will never vanish. No. You have to stick to what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came up with. Because right after the ayah which I recited, which says, اذكروا إذ أنتم قليل مستضعفون في الأرض فأواكم الله وأيدكم بنصره ورزقكم من الطيبات لعلكم تشكرون. Then he says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا. Now I did that for you, and I can do it again. And Allah can do it again, and will do it again, once we deserve that. He says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تخونوا الله والرسول وأماناتكم. Once I bestow my favor, my victory upon you, once I give that to you, never betray Allah and the Messenger. Do not lose that amanah. وَلَا تَخُونُوا أَمَانَاتِكُمْ. Do not betray the trust that you have been entrusted with. What is it that we have been entrusted with? What is it that Allah Azza wa Jal entrusted us with as an ummah? From the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He entrusted us with the justice, that you must establish justice wherever you are. Allah Azza wa Jal designated the Prophet, the messengers, and He sent books and scales and systems and rules so that people live in justice. As long as oppression is there and you have not stood up for the justice, the real justice that came from Allah Azza wa Jal, you will not get that victory in your hand. And you have lost the trust. What also the trust? The trust, look at the wealth in the ummah, in the world. I'm talking about material wealth. Food. Do we know that the amount of food that gets dumped in the oceans today is double or more than double the amount of food that is in the markets? And you tell me that there are some people who cannot find food, cannot eat? Not only in Gaza, not only in Syria, not only in Myanmar, but all over the world. In America, in Africa, in Latin America, more than 1 billion people in the world today, more than 1 billion, they lack the sufficient amount of food to sustain their life. That's a trust. That's a trust. We lost that trust. The Muslim Ummah did lose that trust. We let go of that trust. The other trust, the killing of the people, massacres, entire world, including the world. I don't blame the people of the world who do not have a message, who were not entrusted, whom Allah Azza wa Jal did not bestow his trust into them. I don't blame them. That's their life. That's the idol they live in. I blame the Muslim Ummah who were given that message, that mercy of Allah, gave it to their Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and who became the Ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and we failed to carry that message and to stand up for the justice that Allah Azza wa Jal wanted us to create in this world. Aside from that, now, do we have as an ummah what it takes to come back? Of course we do. I don't want to sound negative as from the first part of the speech, but I want to instigate in us that we still have what it takes. Isn't Allah Azza wa Jal vowed to preserve this book?
Yes.
He did. Doesn't this book have the rules, the regulations, and motivations, all what it takes to bring an ummah from the graves even? Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Aren't we going in the next month, coming Ramadan, to read this Quran once or twice or three or four times in this masjid and in the entire world? Yes, we are. Are we taking this as serious as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam took it and his companions? Not yet. But we have to seize the opportunity to see all the atrocities that are taking place. Not only in Gaza. Gaza is an example. It's a magnified example. It's a magnified example. There are many other places where the media, Al Jazeera, doesn't broadcast. Or CNN does not broadcast. There are people who die days and nights, children who get killed, who get thrown out of this world without any reason, all over the world. But this book, Al-Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the leadership of Muhammad. When we read Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we should not only read how he prayed 5 times a day. We do that, but we should read how he led the world. We should detect and take out of that whole history the leadership of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is an outstanding in the entire world. Until today, anyone who talks about leadership, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes up first. And you know the book that keeps the 100 most prominent leaders for the last decades, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam stand up number one. Stand up number one in the books of history. And we love it to say, oh, Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is number one leader in the world. But we as an ummah, we should be following him. We have what it takes to come back, brothers. We have what it takes to be the ones, the vanguards of humanity in this world. We are the ones, the Muslim ummah, who can protect all these rights what they call now, talk about the human rights, talk about the genocides, talk about all of this had turned out into in front of the people as this is absolutely hoax. It's hoax. It works only when you are the victims. When you are the victims, I'm sorry. When you are the victims, it never works. There is nothing called the human right for the oppressed. There is nothing called the right to live for the oppressed. There is nothing called genocide for the ones who are absolutely powerless. I will conclude this with this almost like an anecdote. The other day when the International Court of Justice, they made their so-called verdicts. We call upon the Israeli government to restrain its army from committing genocide. What a joke. You are calling upon the unit, the entity that controls the army. Say, please tell your soldiers to be easy on these people. That's the justice that the world demands. I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to enable us to get back to our senses, to our Islam, to our Quran, to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to save us, our skins, our children, our people, and the rest of the world as well. Amen. Alhamdulillah, may all the praise be to Allah. May Allah has His forgiveness, His mercy upon us. To enable us to come back to Him, to His support, so that we can gain His favor upon us, His mercy, His victory, and to make us among those who deserve His rahmah in this world and in the hereafter. And I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to forgive all our sins. And to make our feet solid in this earth, so we can achieve and deliver what we are supposed to deliver. I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to have His mercy upon our parents, upon the people who have favor upon us, who taught us this deen, this Islam, and the knowledge and the wisdom, inshaAllah. Allahumma inni as'aluka fi hadha al-yawmi al-'azim an la tad'a lana dhanban illa ghafarta. Amin. La sayyi'ata illa ma hamadtaha wa la mu'minata illa wada'taha ya rabbal alamin. Allahumma ighfir lana al-dhunub allati tahlikul 'isam. Allahumma ighfir lana al-dhunub allati tubaddilu an-ni'am. Allahumma ighfir lana al-dhunub allati tajlibu an-niqam. Allahumma ya rabb انصرنا على اعدائنا يا رب العالمين. ومكن لنا في الارض يا رب العالمين. اللهم من علينا بنصر عزيز منزل من عندك يا الله. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستحقون النصر من عندك. اللهم مكننا يا رب ان نكون من المتوكلين عليك لا متوكلين على غيرك يا رب العالمين. ومن علينا وعلى المسلمين اجمع بقيام دوله الاسلام، دوله الخلافه الراشده. بكتابك وسنة نبيك ونجاهد فيها في سبيلك يا رب العالمين. آمين. نوحد كلمة المسلمين في الأرض كلها. اجعلنا أمة واحدة نقوم بأمرك ونهتدي بهدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم.
آمين.
والحمد لله رب العالمين، وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.